I love science. I love science because science makes it possible to understand the world we live in. And that's such an amazing thing that we can actually understand what's going on. It wasn't always like that for me, so let me tell you my story and how I got into science communication. When I was a kid, I loved puzzles. My parents gave me puzzles. I loved playing chess. I loved, you know, being out playing with nature. And then I started school, and we had math in school. But something happened during those 10 years. After 10 years of school, I didn't like math anymore, or science. I was good at it. I could do the formulas, I could do the calculations, but I thought it was boring. I thought it was cold. I thought it was detached from life. You know, life is love and nature and things that matter. And when I thought about computers, I thought about something else. And then I started studying at the university. I took Latin, I took philosophy, and in philosophy we took logic. And slowly I started asking questions like, how can we really know that something is true? How can we know that the stuff that goes on in mathematics is really true? And I was so fascinated with logic that I kept on studying it, and I did a PhD in theoretical mathematical logic, of all things. Pure math. I did that for 6 years, solving one problem for those 6 years. And then I came up with, a better understanding of what mathematics is all about. I understood that mathematics is about life, it's about nature, it is about what goes on, and it enables us to understand what is going on in nature. In this flower, we have so much mathematics. And we have really abstract mathematics as well, like in these five Platonic solids. And mathematics is about representing nature somehow. We use symbols for this. And this has nothing to do with mindless calculations. It has something to do with representing something with symbols. This is something very unique to mankind. And I realized that that's what it's about. It's about representing. It's also about games. Did you know that this game was solved in 1988? The first player has a winning strategy, done by math. We realize this by analyzing it deeply. And this game is so deep that to understand it requires a deep understanding. It may be equivalent to one of the hardest mathematical problems ever. And this object has so much mathematics in it. 40 billion billion combinations you can have with this cube. And it takes only 20 moves to solve it. And that's such a big contrast. You have 20 over here, and you have 40 billion billion over here. How are these connected? This simple fact and this enormous number. So I realized that that's what mathematics is all about. And I really wanted to communicate that out to the world. And I've done so for the last 10 years or so. And I have four things that matter to me when I talk about mathematics and when I talk about science in general. I want it to be interactive, because interactivity works. You pull people in and you engage. I want something that works immediately, with no setup. I want to fascinate people, like magicians do. They create that spark, that curiosity. I want to create that same spark. And last, but most important, we need to tell good stories about mathematics. Think about that. What we do in our culture and what we say about mathematics and science, it really matters. And I think we have a responsibility, in particular for our kids, to tell good stories. So let me give you some examples of the stories we can tell about mathematics. Just take the flower again. With computer science and with programs and programming languages that are so easy to use, we can simulate how this flower comes to be. This is a little simulation where I'm spitting out small triangles. with an angle that corresponds to the golden ratio. If you blow it up a little bit, we get this image. This is exactly what goes on in a sunflower, but I can tell you that story interactively. I can show it to you like this. Let's take another phenomenon in nature. This is flocking of birds. Just have a look at this video. So what we see here are different kinds of flocking behavior. And we can ask interesting questions like, why don't they fly all over? Or why aren't they not all in the same place? Why do they move like they move? And we can then go to the computer and simulate this behavior. There are some simple rules that govern flocking, and we can simulate this in this way. These three simple rules are: one, if you're far away from the others, go there. If it's too crowded, go away. And keep the same direction as the one around you. And this emerges from those three rules. So we see again, we have something very simple, the simple rules and this complex behavior. We can change the rules like this, and then we get a little bit different behavior, different flocking. And by simulating, we can understand what goes on in nature. Let's do another example. Let's imagine that you're on an infinite grid. You're this triangle, and the rules are as follows. If it's black where you're standing, change the color, move to the right, like this. And if you do that over and over again, this happens. And this let's change the rule a little bit. If it's white, then go left. Okay, we go left. But now it's black again, and now we're going right. So right, 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 and now left. But now right, 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 right. But now we go three times left. And now we can ask questions, what happens after a while? So let's have a look at about 100 steps or so. This looks nice. Very symmetrical and beautiful, maybe. And now we can ask the question, what happens, you know, after 10,000 steps? Let's have a look. This happens. And after about 10,500 steps, this happens. And this is going to go on for infinitely long if I hadn't stopped it. Why? We have no idea at all. We simply don't know. This is so complex that humanity, we don't know. We think that no matter what configuration you start in, this will always eventually happen, but mathematicians are not able to prove it. They have proved one thing: this blob is going to grow indefinitely. So mathematics is also about playing games, changing the rules a little bit. So let's just do that. Let's introduce another color, red. So now we have white, black, and red. And this blob just grows and grows. This is 12,000 steps. What do you think happens in a million step? Let's have a look. This is 1 million steps, and we simply don't know. Perhaps it turns into a highway that goes on infinitely long. Perhaps not. We simply don't know. From these simple rules, we have reached a phenomenon that we don't know the answer to. Let's play more games. We can add another color. Let's say green as well. And then we get this beautiful image, and perhaps this will turn into something beautiful and symmetric. And if we run the simulation, this happens. This is 2 million steps of that with four colors. We have no idea where that's going to go if we run it forever. So this is what mathematics is all about. It's also with connecting to nature. Perhaps nature is built up from simple rules. And today we have microcontrollers that enables us to do that. This is one of them. And here we gave a little course for 16-year-old students with no background in programming at all. Within 3 hours, we wanted them to build a scientific measuring equipment device in order to analyze this mystery milk, which is a solution based on milk and water. And we asked them, build something so you can analyze this and find out how much milk it is. Within 3 hours, these kids built their own measuring equipment and found out really precisely exactly how much milk it was. And that I find really amazing. We have these tools today that enables us to do this. We have programming languages that's so easy. So this entire code gives us this image. And this code gives us this image. I'm not asking you to understand that code now, but I'm showing you how little code. Let's take this code and load an image into the computer. And with this code, you get this behavior. And this is so easy to use. you can teach this to 16-year-olds, like we did this summer. Within 3 hours, we enabled them to do advanced computer graphics. Okay, so let me tell you a little bit about what I've done. So I combined the microcontrollers and these programming languages in order to make the physics of roller coasters a little bit more interesting. The physics of roller coasters is great because we have kinetic energy, we have potential energy, we have acceleration, we have speed, and all these things that we can talk about. That's great. But we wanted to do it a little bit differently. So I hired a bunch of students with background in physics and computer science, and then we went to the theme park. And that's the best summer job they ever had, I think. And we rode roller coasters, and we explained the roller coasters to the participants, and then we put measuring equipment on the participants, and we made movies. I would like to show you one of these movies that we made, or a little collage of them. So what you see in the bottom left is the graph of the acceleration. So the red one is up and down acceleration, and the green and the blue is forward and sideways. And you can actually see the raw data and what we experienced during the roller coasters. So let's have a look at this.
We go to flee. Se på utsikten! Oi, neste gang så får vi helt fantastisk utsikt bortover der! Se på utsikten!
Much fun this summer doing this, and we did it to tell a different story about physics and mathematics and trying to combine these technologies, and not only to do it but also to inspire people to do it themselves, because these things are so easy to use. We used simple microcontrollers and programming languages to do this. Okay, on the topic of gravity, I would like to talk a little bit about juggling. Juggling is a very good example of science. Do you know what juggling is? Okay, so this is juggling. This is me juggling three balls. And you see, I can juggle them a little bit differently. I can juggle like this, which is another pattern. There's something else going on. Or even like this, which is another totally different pattern. So then you can start to ask questions. What is really going on? What is going on? And this gave rise to a mathematics of juggling. So let me briefly explain to you the mathematics of juggling. You see these numbers? They represent throws. So this is a 1, this is a 2, this is a 3, this is a 4, and the definition of a number is how long it takes before the ball is rethrown. So let's do these numbers. This is 3-1, what everyone juggles. 3-1, 3-1, 3-1, 3-1, 3-1. This pattern is called 2. 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2. Let's combine them. Let's do 3-1, 2, 3-1, 2, 3-1, 2, 3-1, 2, 3-1, 2. Can you see it? You should try this. And with three balls, you have this pattern is called just three. I throw threes now. Three, 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 three. And I could juggle 4-4-1. 4-4-1, 4-4-1, 4-4-1, 4-4. You see? And I could juggle 4-4-1-3, which is a combination of these two. 4-4-1-3. Okay, so this gave rise to a totally... Thank you. And now, when you do the mathematics of juggling, you're able to juggle things that you were not able to juggle before. And that's what science is about. It's representing these things as numbers and then go back to the world with new insight. Okay, we wanted to do this also a little bit differently. This is a friend of mine, and we decided to build computers into the juggling balls. So we did. We made small circuit boards like this with accelerometer, with radio, with a little battery, and with lights. And we 3D printed these shells and built the computers into the balls. You put it in, you lock it up, and then you have fun. And let me show you what that looks like. So here I have a ball. It lights up red when I throw it in the air. You can see this? and it detects that it is in the air. It knows that it's in the air. So let's juggle two balls and see what happens. Then they turn yellow. They communicate. If I stop and I do only one, it turns red again. And yeah. And I could do the pattern 3-1. So it actually detects the pattern and it turns green and red. So the 3 is a green and the red is a 1. 3-1, 3-1, 3-1, 2, 3-1, 2, 3. And you see the 2 is yellow again, like it's supposed to be. So, and with 3 balls, they should turn green if they're programmed correctly. If I stop, they stop as well. So with this stuff, we can communicate science. We can tell stories. We can do it interactively. We can do it immediately. And we can create that spark, that fascination that enables our kids and our friends to fall in love with science. Thank you.